woman in Cross River State's smart home with cash grants from the federal government with hopes that this will better their lives. His love for nature caused him to adopt an animal, but what kind of animal did he adopt? This is where the curiosity lies. Do you want to know? If you want to know, stay with us. For an alleged involvement in extramarital affair and without evidence to back up the claims, a cleric, while awaiting to perform religious rites, is sent to his early grave. This and more have made our package of Sunday special a must-watch, and I trust that you won't want to miss it. Welcome to our Sunday special. I am Justina Etham. Welcome back. The Minister of Defense, Major General Bashir Magashi, retired, has led Nigeria's Chief of Defense Staff and Service Chiefs to Theater Command Operation Lafia Dole on operational visit to Maiduguri, the Borno State capital. The Defense Minister is accompanied by the Chief of Defense Staff, General Lucky Irabo, Chief of Army Staff, Major General Ibrahim Atahiru, Chief of the Air Staff, Air Marshal Isiaka Amao, and representative of the Chief of Naval Staff. At the Theater Command, Operation Lafia Dole, the Theater Commander, Major General Farouk Yahaya, disclosed that the visit is for the Minister to see firsthand how the troops are faring and interact with them. This is the first combined visit of the Minister in company of the new service chiefs. The minister had addressed troops and is expected to visit the wounded receiving treatment in the 7th Divisional Hospital. The Defense Minister, Chief of Defense Staff and Service Chiefs are also expected to meet Borno State Governor Professor Babagana Umaru Zulum at the Government House, Maiduguri. The Federal Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs, Disaster Management and Social Development has flagged off the disbursement of 20,000 Naira cash grants to 28,000 rural women in Cross River State. Paul Ebel reports that beneficiaries are the poor and vulnerable, drawn from the 18 local government areas of the state.
The National Social Investment Program, NSIP, established in 2015 by the President Muhammadu Buhari-led administration, is one of the largest in Africa, with over $1 billion earmarked annually. So far, more than 12 million households of the poorest of the poor and the vulnerable, including persons with disabilities, have benefited from these interventions. For Ita Asoko Eyo and other beneficiaries, the intervention by federal government is commendable as the grant will help improve their living standards.
I will use the money and buy more oil and sell.
To give them that enablement to do to others as they did to me.
I really thank them sincerely for what they have done for us.
Minister of Humanitarian Affairs, Disaster Management and Social Development, Sadia Umar Farouk, represented by the National Coordinator of the program, and the state government say the measure is to drastically reduce poverty in Nigeria.
We believe that this 20,000 will become bigger amounts of money. It will re-energize their small businesses and possibly employ not only them, but employ others and create wealth.
I expect them to do exceedingly well. I've always said it, the future of Nigeria is women.
If this trend is sustained by the federal government, it is hopeful that by the year 2030, over 100 million will be taken out of poverty. In Calabar, Paul Abel, NTA News.
Meanwhile, the federal government has completed plans to establish a special agro-processing zone in Ekum, Cross River State, for the South-South region in Nigeria. A federal government delegation said this during an inspection of agro-allied industries in Cross River State. Paul Ebel tells us more.
The federal government, under the leadership of President Muhammadu Buhari, has continued to make giant strides in the agricultural sector, and again it is proving its mettle, with Cross River State serving as the hub for agricultural processing activities in South Nigeria. The delegation, comprising representatives from the Federal Ministry of Agriculture, Finance, African Development Bank, and the International Fund for Agriculture Development, are on a pre-appraisal mission to appraise the level of Cross River State government's preparedness for the project.
We want other countries to use our finished product. That's why SAPC is very, very key.
Really applauded the level of preparation and the structure and narrative, you know, that follows through regarding the states.
Cross River has really shown us that they are ready, are more than ready for the SAPZ.
Cross River State Governor, represented by his deputy, Professor Ivara Esu, appreciates the team and the federal government for citing the agro-processing zone in Cross River State and for recognizing the efforts of his administration and the agro-industrial revolution.
The state we have reached, we cannot come back. As far as agro-processing industries and also the production of agricultural raw materials are concerned.
It's a win for Cross River State for this special agro-processing zone to be located in Cross River State.
All they have is marvel at the giant strides of what we have done in Cross River State.
They are excitingly satisfied with what they've seen.
The team toured around some agriculture projects in the state, which include the ultra-modern rice milling factory, Oguja, Bansora Rice Farm and Mills, Granite Oil Processing Factory, Bikwara. Others are Cocoa Processing Factory, Ikam, Cassava Processing Center, Obubra, Ayade Industrial Park, Calabar, as well as some private firms in the state. In Calabar, Paul Abel, NTA News.
And now talking health, 60 confirmed new cases of COVID-19 have been recorded in Nigeria. Lagos, with the highest number of the virus, recorded 22 cases, followed by Rivers, 15, Bayelsa, 7, Kaduna, 5, Ogun, 4, Akwa Ibom, 3, Osun, 2, Kano and Ebonyi, 1 case each. There are 164,207 confirmed cases, 154,325 discharged, and 2,061 deaths. You're watching the news live from the studio of the Nigerian Television Authority, Channel 9 Calabar. You can equally watch this newscast on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/NTA Calabar. We'll bring to you our Sunday special stories after this break. Please stay with us.
Everyday events occur, and as they occur, we bring them to you anywhere you are. News updates showing on your channel of choice, NTA Channel 9 Calabar, affords you opportunity to get it fresh, hot, and loaded. 3 minutes newscast of headline story every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. You can't afford to miss it. It is the news update on NTA Calabar, the station for the people.
Welcome back. The acronym Come and Live and Be at Rest is often used to describe Calabar, the Cross River State capital, based on its once peaceful disposition. However, this tranquility seems to be fast eluding the city due to increasing rates of crimes, with the recent being allegations of beheaded bodies dumped in a valley and other crimes. Correspondent takes a look at the security situation in the city of Calabar and now reports. It was due to increasing cases of kidnapping, armed robbery, cultism, and the likes that the Cross River State government constituted a joint security outfit codenamed Operation Akpaku to tackle these challenges, and this task force has to an extent lived up to expectation. Just when it seems like the people of Calabar were sleeping with their eyes closed, crimes and criminalities are resurfacing in the metropolis, and the recent is the story of severe decomposed bodies dumped in a valley, as well as allegations of a 58-year-old woman raped and murdered in her residence, trending in the social media. These and other incidents have left residents questioning the effectiveness of the joint security outfit, as well as the 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. curfew still in force in the city.
How do these people get into Calabar when we know that at all these strategic points there are security operatives? How do they come in to commit these crimes that we are hearing about, all this unrest?
Even day before yesterday, they robbed parliamentary area, and that is not good. Even this operation Akpako, they are not helping matters, because you can see crimes are still going on here and there, and this curfew of a thing is so bad.
To a level, it is controlled now, but I think also, while we congratulate the Excellency for taking that bold step, we also encourage him to also fortify it again, or like let him step it up again. Because recently, around the Korefang axis, in 8 miles, and some of these areas, hoodlums attacks have started again.
The Cross River State Command of the Nigeria Civil Defense Corps confirmed that 8 decomposing bodies were found in a valley, though they were not headless.
Men were at the scene. They saw it and they came back and reported to us that the bodies they saw were approximately about 8. And from their statistics, it was like 7 male and 1 female. And most of the bodies are already decomposing. So identity becomes a problem. Until investigation is concluded, we can't tell you what really happened.
The police public relations officer in a telephone call says the command has not received any reports on the dead bodies, while the young man who claimed on social media that his mother was raped and murdered is not picking her calls. In Calabar, Justina Etem, NTA News.
When inflation increases, the purchasing power of a currency depreciates, resulting in rising cost of all goods and services. Fluctuating inflation rates from research affect stakeholders in an economy, including consumers, investors, corporations, and governments. In this report, Aritindem expressed the effect of dollar on the cost of goods and services.
Research shows that the consequences of inflation is that it makes it more difficult for people to afford basic necessities, not only foodstuff, but also cars, clothes, shoes, human hairs, and more.
Cost of the dollar now had really affected our market. Like, let's say, starting from the closure now, we saw closure for 1.8. Now, the price had gone, because of the increase of dollar, the price had gone so high that we're now selling for 8,000 naira.
Comparing prices of goods between this year and last year, I'll say it's actually higher now because of the dollar increment. And when we go to the market, we buy stuff for, like, let's say 7,000. You're coming back with the hope of selling it 8,000 naira. And with shipping and other things, it increases more than that.
See, before, we used to buy it at 5,000 for something. Now, because of the dollar, we can't even buy tire again. Now, tire is not 7,000 now. We can't even buy tire. And oil before, like Powerflow, it was before 2,700. And Powerflow now is 5,500.
Many years ago, like 8 years, 6 years, 7, we are buying dollar 160 to 165. But now, things have changed. We are buying it now 478 and sell 482. So from now you will see the difference of situation.
Inflation can also result in untold hardship to many Nigerian families who struggle to keep up with the daily needs. Some sellers speak on the high cost of commodities, attributing the development to border closure and the increase in the pump price.
The increment of fuel, all those things will make all the price go high. So it's not all about dollar. We are not buying our things here in naira, in dollars. We are using naira here.
I used to buy 500 naira. You go stay there for market. Nobody will come and patronize you for this our market. Me, I pray to Almighty God, let him come and help us for this ugly situation.
Plantain I buy last year. Now I buy 1,000 naira for bunch. I know if you sell 1,000 naira.
If I carry come now 1,500, 1,700, sell and come out my money with transport. If I no say that, that no go come out.
The effect of dollar market inflation does not just devalue the Nigerian currency, but also reduces the cost of living. In Calabar, Arut Ndem, NTA News.
Animals, they say, are such agreeable friends. They ask no questions, they pass no criticism. Can this possibly be responsible for the adoption of a lion by a family in Imo State? Let's find out from Marian Vincent Okor, who caught up with the nature lovers.
To think of an animal as less privileged is almost unimaginable, as human beings are usually accorded such description, which sometimes results in the adoption of such individuals. So, when the invitation was extended to yours truly to witness the adoption of a lion, it sounded more like a joke, especially considering the present economic realities. Curious to find out who could be behind the adoption of the lion, we set out to the Imo Zoological Garden, Nekede. While the zoological garden has a total of 3 lions, the object of interest here is Roy. The question now is, why would anyone want to adopt an animal, and a lion at that?
Financially, the value of one lion is over $250,000 or more. So losing one because of inability to feed is something that touched me, that said, okay, let us take this in as we will set up a scholarship foundation for one or two kids out there and sponsor them and help them. So the adoption does not necessarily mean that they're going to live with us as human in the family. It means that we have them in our mind monthly, yearly, to continue to support their survival.
While the Lion Kings were locked up in their cages, Roy was allowed to be held by Mr. Nwiko, and believe me, the sight of it almost took the breath out of onlookers.
This is the first time we are seeing this in this part of the country. I know adoption of expensive animal to maintain happens in the north, it happens in the west, but in the southeast, I have advocated severally for our big men to extend a hand of fellowship to this animal. You know what I hear? You might be have not eaten, you are asking us to come and feed animals.
It might interest you to know that in Umuogbaagu community in Ngokpala local government area of Imo State, where Onwiko hails from, lions are seen as a part of the community. Hence, the killing of one is considered a sacrilege.
In Opala, it is a deity, sort of.
If we go to our river now, and even interview any elderly man, we tell you that our lion are still alive in our river there.
As a child, when we used to come to this water to take shower or fetch water, we used to hear their roar down into the jungle here. When you're standing here to fetch water, the vibration alone will make you drop your water and run away. But in all that roaring, we will hear it sometimes even very close.
With this adoption, the sole responsibility of feeding and funding of other issues affecting the lion is now taken off the managers of the zoo.
Lion take almost 65% of our feeding budget. Okay? So you can understand from this that the cost of feeding lion is huge.
Though it will remain in the custody of the zoological garden, Roy can now also visit the adopted family once in a while.
Over the years, jealousy, anger, and suspicion have been known to strain relationships and marriages, and many who dared this path have been sent to their early graves. This scenario played out when a 35-year-old suspect by name Umar Jibril allegedly killed 48-year-old cleric Atahiru Al-Hassan for an unsubstantiated claim that the deceased has been having extramarital affairs with his wife in Enagi, Niger State. Oriyomi Olagunju brings details of the sad story captured through the eyes of eyewitness.
Pandemonium was let loose in a sleepy community of Enagi, the headquarters of Edati local government area of Niger State, when a 35-year-old Umar hanged to death the deceased, who happened to also be his cousin, as they shared the same maternal grandparents. On that fateful day, the deceased, the chief imam of Enagi, Atahiru Al-Hassan, like many other clerics, was reportedly busy looking out for the new moon that heralded the month of Ramadan without premonition of a fatal encounter that death was lurking around the corner, as corroborated by an eyewitness account.
So many people here, when people are congratulating about the sighting of Ramadan moon, it was on the process of calling phone that this boy came that I want to talk to him. The man said, allow me to finish. People hear it. Calling the imam, he now draw the man closer to the where he killed this man. He now tell him, oh, I'm going to kill you today. The man said, what did I do? He said, I'm going to kill you today. What you led? I'm going to kill you today. There's one wood there. He now hit him on the head. Now took a knife. That's all.
The unwarranted killing has put the town into a pensive mood, as demonstrated by this eyewitness, who is still struggling to come to terms with the gruesome murder. His emotions fail him while trying to narrate the ordeal. Contrary to the confessional account of the suspect, Umar Jibril, to the police, who alleged that he caught the disease in the act having carnal knowledge of his second wife, 30-year-old Aisha, mother of two at a neighbor's house, Mohammed Bida, is the owner of this apartment allegedly used to commit the act.
I went to my village to bring my family to come and fast with me, though the imam usually comes to relax with me whenever I am around. When I was traveling, I locked the house and I did not give the deceased my key. So I wonder where the suspect got his story from.
Investigation also revealed that both the suspect and his now estranged wife have been in a turbulent relationship, in which the chief imam has always been mediating due to the role he played during their wedding, until the deceased denounced the role recently and tragedy struck.
From onset, chief imam, that is the deceased, was the one as what we people call wakil. When this our brother is looking hand in marriage with the girl, that is Aisha from Kutigi. But in the process of their marital life, they used to have a lot of confrontations within themselves, which he, the suspect, is fond of insensitive pronunciation of I divorced, repeatedly. The man, being the leader of the religion, he said insistent pronunciation of I divorce you. They didn't teach him like that, and they didn't see in the holy book like that. So with that, he cannot do any reconciliation. Let them go and do it themselves. If they see, they can do. So the husband, he now went to Kutigi again, say he is looking for reconciliation. This is what the man said. They now say they have made their final verdict that it is the man that can say the final thing, and he has said it. So left for them, there has nothing to say. So to my understanding, that pronunciation of I cannot do it, that is maybe likely what invoked the boy.
Investigation has since commenced into this incident, and just as you have seen the suspect with us, as soon as we conclude investigation, he will definitely be charged to court as soon as courts resume work.
Yes, I am full of regrets, as my anger got the best of me. If not, I will not be here.
We'll be leaving you with the words of Robert Kennedy, which says, tragedy is a tool for the living to gain wisdom, not a guard by when to leave. Oriyomi Olagunju, NTA News.
And with that report, we've come to the end of our Sunday special. Thank you so much for watching and have a wonderful evening.